all for coming this weekend. This is our now third annual winter lecture at Sleepy Hollow. Yes. And we're so excited that you all could come up, and it looks like we may all be staying here together for a while too, based on the weather. But we only had one family cancel because of the weather. So obviously there's a lot of excitement about our program today for good reason. This is the agenda for the afternoon, and we're absolutely delighted to have Paul Gray here with us today, sharing some historic video and memories of Sleepy Hollow, and some of our own local talent for other speakers to discuss their knowledge of Sleepy Hollow. We're going to have dinner, music, and more music, depending on how the evening goes along. A lot of people put a lot of work into making this happen, and we're very excited about it. We've got our speakers who have prepared for this, our committee, and I also wanted to specifically thank the Historical Association of South Haven. I wasn't familiar with them, I don't know if you all are, but I wanted to put a plug in that they provided some of the photographs that you'll see tonight, and they apparently have acquired the lighthouse, and so they're going to be starting a capital campaign to raise funds for the preservation of the lighthouse. And so if anyone's interested in becoming a member or making a donation, look for their information coming out soon. They said they'd be putting in new flyers at the Visitors Bureau and such, and hopefully we'll drop some off here as well. I hope everyone enjoys this. We're so excited that you were all able to come. Thank you for being a part of the history of Sleepy Hollow and for continuing on with some of the traditions that we've had going on here for many years. And I'd like to start with Paul Gray.
Thank you, Jody. I'm Paul Gray. My grandfather, Edward, who discovered this property for us. He had brought his family, seven children, wife, and probably assorted cousins and other hangers-on. He brought them to South Haven in the early 30s. They stayed at places like Barron's Resort and a few others, and he decided that he needed a place to bring his family in the summers, and found this property, from what we understand, in 1936, late 1936. Bought the property. What I'm going to show you are a series of films that he took starting in 1937, the first season that they had the property, and showing some of the renovations that they did to the buildings that were here at that time. There was a farmhouse where our house is today, and he remodeled that that first year. The building that we call 37 was also a small farmhouse that was remodeled that year, and the building that Town Cottage A, which used to sit on the lakefront, was also a small cabin at that time. I think the only other buildings on the property were the barn and a couple of farm buildings that have long since been torn down. But when he bought the property, it was almost all cornfield. There was a small orchard around our house, and quite a few mature elm trees that were planted around the turn of the previous century when there was a hotel on the property that was occasionally known as Sleepy Hollow and sometimes also as the Brighton Beach Hotel. But that hotel was gone, I think, after about 1915 when it burned down. And the property went back to being a farm for the 20 years or so that my grandfather bought. So he started bringing his children to the property in 1937-38, and they came every summer for many, many years. I was born in 54 and started coming here the first summer of 55, and every summer afterwards, including summer of 73 when I helped to manage the place when I was just 18. The manager that we had that year apparently had a heart attack or something in the spring and was not available, and my dad was at the end of his wits because he was already very deeply into another business, and that was the summer that I met the Davises. They bought their unit in the Gateway, which is still known as the Gateway Building.
Oh, yes.
All right. Well, let's start. This is my son Ian, by the way.
Hello.
I don't really have a prepared history. I just thought we could talk and look at the pictures and see what questions come up.
So again, this is summer of 1937. My grandfather made these films, and that's the house which was remodeled into our house. You can drag that block down to the bottom of the picture if you want to. That black, this is the stairway to the beach, which we still use today. Evidently, that stairway was put in when that hotel was there at the turn of the previous century.
Paul, sometimes you see pilings down when the water is low, down off of this stairway?
Yes. I was told that there was a small pier there around the time that the Brighton Beach Hotel existed. We don't know that for a fact, but that's what I was told. My grandfather was in the construction business in Chicago, and they also did a lot of demolition, including they demolished the World's Fair of 1933. And they had a lot of materials left over from those projects that they brought up here, and in fact, during the Depression, you had a lot of workers that weren't that busy also. So one of the things they did was build Cottage Row. And you'll see a little bit later on in the film, laying out the Cottage Row and the construction of all the cottages. Mm-hmm. That was the first summer after they renovated the big house. It must be 38.
Much more than a farmhouse.
Well, the shape of the house was the same as it is today, the roof shape and everything.
Yeah.
It looked more Victorian because it was actually built or renovated sometime around the turn of the previous century. When he renovated it, that's when they put the stone facade in, they put the round windows in, which were sort of popular in the 30s. They put an addition onto it. This is what is now Cottage A. They were remodeling at that time. Right on the,
Cottage Row.
It looks like we're already here at the Cottage Row. Sorry.
Was the house that he built ever used for longer than just summer vacations?
No. Not since we've owned the property.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay, there you see the pilings that originally the cottages were all built on.
Yeah.
I have no idea who these guys are. I suppose they probably all worked for, my grandfather's company.
So who designed the houses for Kaiser?
All of them were designed by this architect, Elmer Carlson, who did all the renovations on the main house. He designed the office, the terrace, the cottages. I think you have blueprints that we did.
Big box.
He was a Chicago-based architect from the South Side. The aesthetic was largely drawn from Art Moderne, which was a big thing at the 1933 World's Fair. My grandfather liked it. It signified modern. And if you look at the early brochure of the Sleepy Hollow, it's all about how modern it is. Actual kitchens, indoor bathrooms.
So the windows actually look new. I always thought the windows were salvaged.
No. All those materials, the only materials that they salvaged really were the bricks and the steel bar joists.
Really?
These joists that have steel.
Yeah.
Right. Those bar joists came from some
project. No bathroom fixture?
I don't think so. I think they were all new. I can remember in the 60s, there were still some new bathroom fixtures in crates stacked in the barn. When we remodeled the barn and made it into a theater, there were all kinds of things like that, building materials left over. So this is right after the house renovation was completed. You can actually see the copper shining above the windows. See, I have some notes about this on this film, let me get them out.
Which way do you think they're looking? Down towards the...
It's down toward the road, isn't it?
Down towards the road, right?
Probably.
Look at that lap, that's a different lap.
Oh, yeah, okay. There's all the original drainage pipes that were getting ready to lay in. At 41 minutes, there's a picture of the cornfields that are between Cottage Row and the main house. They're plowing with a horse.
Yeah, they just went through that.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
There's not any dirt to start to see.
No, you're only at 35 minutes, I think, right?
41.
How long did it take them to build all these, one summer or more?
I think they built all the cottages in one summer. And then over the next couple of summers, the remainder of the buildings.
Oh, there you go.
This is just between us and, between the main house and Cottage Row. And this is them planting the cedar trees. That line, they used to line the road between the front of the terrace and the patio. That's the old cottage, by the way.
There's, that's the picture.
This was all cornfields at the time. Let's see, okay, this begins the early 1940s.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah.
There's a picture of that.
I remember that.
I think the next film is dated 1942.
The old building was still there.
Slave labor.
Some of my uncles and aunts are in this film. And there is a little bit of film of my grandparents that you'll see in 2 minutes. Yeah, this is one of my aunts, Janice.
She was a very glamorous woman.
Yeah, those are various uncles. At 40, that's the music tower. At 46 minutes, he has the pictures of Grandpa and Grandma.
We're at 46 minutes
right
now.
Almost there.
Yeah, what is that?
That's the terrace building.
Wow.
Yeah.
I like the awning. Put them back.
Cottage Row. Okay, there's my grandfather.
He has some sweaters.
He was about 50.
Can't believe he wore his tie here.
What year was this now?
This is 1942, I think. It's 1941, probably, because they moved to Miami
73 years ago
during the war. That's my grandmother. She would have been 40 here, but she was 10 years younger.
Oh, my God.
That's the D&E building. This is a formal rose garden that they built on this former site of the cornfield. For about 20 years, in the 40s and 50s, it was maintained with sculpture and beautiful pathways and arbors and roses. And they had a gardener named Frank Bilt who just...
Oh,
Frank.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Still?
Yeah.
Oh,
yes.
We knew he just left.
Is this place open?
No, he's
open. It was open for a while, yeah.
Where's the
gun?
It's been...
Yes,
10 years.
Yeah, I don't think there was ever a season it was closed after 1938.
Yeah, I think you're right. What unit is that? Does anybody know?
I'm sure that woman is turning over in her grave right now.
Looks tan, though.
Obviously, somebody my grandfather had some affection for.
Thank you.
Don't know.
The lake is still there.
Yeah.
I don't think a gray has been in that good of shape since this film was made.
That's the parking area across from the terrace and the patio.
Oh, those cars. And look at the planters.
These barber poles, my grandfather must have bought like a whole truckload of them at some auction or something. They were all over the resort.
Oh my gosh.
Patio.
Oh, there's that. It doesn't look any different.
That one. Just the car.
It's the same.
Exactly the same.
So what year approximately is this one?
We're still in the 40s.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the Rose Garden as it's starting to get warm.
So there was no pool there?
That'd be about where you were married, Anita?
Like
right in that little spot?
Can't tell.
There's a barbecue. You can still see that barbecue on the lakefront.
There's our bench, Meredith.
What's the time, Ian? The counter time?
You're at 51 minutes, 45 seconds.
Okay. Let's see. I know they started construction of the pool at 1 hour, 8 minutes.
Don't we have another 10 years to go or so?
Yeah, here we go. Okay, this is 50s. That's the playground in the 50s. If you look carefully.
Oh, I love that.
There were two merry-go-rounds. This one survived until quite recently. I don't know if it's still there.
No.
There's also a tall one that you're going to see.
Bill Cosby called that machine the most dangerous thing in the history of the world for children.
Yeah.
Right?
Wait, you see,
run around really fast and kids go flying off.
They loved it.
Yeah, that was still around when I was a kid. I remember playing on that.
Oh, that was till recently.
We just took it down.
We just decided decapitating children was not a good idea.
Wait, do you remember the high board, the high diving?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Well, you're going to see a diving exhibition at Water Valley.
Well, who ran the resort? Well, I mean, your grandfather was off in his construction business.
It was always run by a hired manager.
That was it.
The first one that I knew was a guy named Bob Schneider, who you guys will probably know.
We didn't know Gannon?
Gannon was in between Bob's two stays, actually.
Okay, here's 51.
Bob Schneider started the first year that my dad owned the property. And that was like 1968.
Just off to the right of the playground, you're going to see another shot.
There's an outdoor movie screen. They used to have outdoor screenings almost every night or so.
Wow, that's like they have today.
Right.
Those new kind of things.
Look at all the kids.
Wow.
Look at this cow.
Construction about 10 years ago, right?
Yeah.
Same buildings. Yeah. It's still good, that's still good.
Aristocrat. I don't know who came up with that. Oh yeah, this is when they built the tennis courts. They hadn't even really put the fence up yet.
Just one.
Two rebuilds.
Yeah. And they built the second one, and the other, the courts across the road were not built until my dad's time, sometime in the 60s. This is still the 50s.
The post there is still the same post, isn't it?
Yeah.
By the entrance?
It's the same light too.
Same what?
Light.
The lights?
Yeah, we have that sphere light up here.
You sure?
Yeah.
It worked?
Yeah.
They took the gate down, huh?
Let's zip ahead a little.
Yeah, sure.
Look how small the tree is.
There we go. This would be the very end of the 50s, I would say.
Oh, wait, what's the time here?
Oh, there's the high one.
We're at 102.
Okay. All right, I guess I'm going to have this film, this film and the next one are a little out of order.
No, it's a clown they have.
That's why I took that off.
This one and the next one are a little out of order because the next one is the building of the pool, which I think was around 57.
It's a stupid show they had for the kids.
They had an MC dressed in a tuxedo with hair. They had clowns, they had a diving exhibition, and then you'll see water ballet in a minute.
It doesn't look nearly as tall here as when you're standing there looking down.
Was that a 3 meter pole?
Yeah, 3 meter. Yeah, 3 meter
water ballet.
This was a big deal in the late 50s. Oh, this is like a cheerleader.
The town twirler.
Wow.
We better go back to some entertainment.
Yeah, yeah, seriously.
Right. It's making us look bad.
Oh, there's children.
So the music is playing while they do this?
Yeah, they had either a record player or a tape recorder, as I recall, playing, you know, some kind of...
I don't know where to look, but you look at it. What's that big circle thing? Is that just
an umbrella? Umbrellas. Oh. Big aluminum umbrellas.
I remember those.
Yeah, I remember those.
Those are the same. Is that the pool with the same pool with the TV screen glass?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
This was the first wall. That one was knocked down by a tornado sometime in the late 60s and then replaced with one that was more or less the same design but a bit more.
But not as high.
Maybe not as high.
No, because I have pictures and
yeah.
It isn't.
I mean,
the glass panels were TV screens, that's what we understood. Yeah.
That's impressive.
What was this event? Was this an annual event or was this a special occasion?
They did this frequently in the summer, you know, when the resort was fully occupied. They'd have different kinds of entertainment. They had a circus. They did, you'll see, folk dancing became really popular.
So would this be professional people, well, more or less hired to come in?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they were hired to come in.
You should bring in a square dancing person to call it.
Yeah. For square dancing, not the metal.
Okay. Enough ballet. I don't guess they did that for too many seasons, probably, when the pool was new and it was a novelty.
Paul, was there ever a piano at the pool?
Not that I remember.
There's someone trying to...
Carol said there was a piano.
This building, this was your laundry until a few years back, I think.
In the famous library.
Snack bar for...
Snack bar.
Well, you're gonna see, actually, the snack bar is just behind that. It's called the Chuck Wagon.
I think we saw the Olympics or something in there.
Kids would hang out over there.
It was a kiddie pool.
Famous kiddie pool. Up to the big concrete block right in the middle, so all kids could kill themselves.
I don't believe too many kids were killed, actually.
And we had to take it out, though, because of the... Didn't we put bumpers on it or something?
Yeah, we did.
By the time I was doing the right thing.
We put bumpers on it.
The swings, I remember.
There's the movie screen, it's the background. We go all around the resort and gather up the benches and carry them over there.
We were renting.
Yeah, we were renting. You just bought right away.
This is now mid-60s. You're going to see the A-frames are here, the dome, the children's dome, that's there at this time. That's one of my uncles.
Looks like you.
That's my youngest uncle, Melvin Gray.
When did they put the place up for, when did they start selling the places?
I think the first season was 73.
71.
Yeah, okay, that's right. Jamie's father was the lawyer who organized the condominium.
71. Okay.
Seasons, something like that, for the association to be sold entirely?
For enough units to be sold, yeah. so that the balance of control switched from your father to the owner. So.
Those were built around 66 or something like that.